Charles I stayed here, and these trees
were planted to commemorate his marriage to Henrietta Maria. So it's hardly surprising that there's an atmosphere of tranquility and venerable age surrounding these grounds. But will our artist be able to capture this atmosphere on paper? Let's go and meet them.
Chris Hull is a former pop musician who now teaches art. He still dreams of making the big time, but perhaps as a professional artist instead of a rock star. Maz Jones used to run an antique shop in Aberystwyth, so she should feel quite at home in the grounds of a castle. It was her birthday yesterday, and I've heard she may be feeling a little pale today. She celebrated by spending the night here with the ghosts of Gwydir. Ken Wilson used to be an architect and a consultant for English Heritage, so old buildings should be right up his street. Ken also admits to a passion for amateur operatics. A talented baritone, he also once directed a BBC production of Oliver.
Well, good morning, team.
Hello, Hannah.
Hiya.
Ah, now, Maz, what we want to know is, you slept here last night. Did you see the ghost?
Not even drifting along.
Not even drifting along. Would you like to have?
Oh, yes, very much.
You could have painted her in this morning.
I may do yet.
Right. Now, talking about drifting along, there is no time for any of that from you this morning, because 4 hours is what you have for this beautiful house. So I will quit the scene and leave you to it. Wish you the very best of luck.
Thank you.
Thank
Bye.
You.
Thank you.
Bye.
At first I was thinking about doing part of the building, but it's such a spectacular building. So I've gone for the a sort of like a panoramic aspect of the whole building. The challenge is to capture the atmosphere. It's got that lovely old sort of quite spooky atmosphere about it, and I want to try and bring that out.
It's quite a hard subject, actually, for me, because I am not the world's best drawer. I like a lot of colour, and I'm going to have to use the imagination a little today.
The challenge is to find an interesting section of the building, and I've picked the what I assume is the main entrance, with the planting around it, which gives me colour. And there is a warmth in the stone, although it's a grey building. There are lovely areas of warmth, which I hope to portray into the areas of wash.
Hello, Mike.
Morning, Hannah.
Mike Chaplin, our artist in residence all this week. Now, Mike, say I said to you, you have got 4 hours. I mean, you're an expert, so it's all very easy to you, but I want you to put yourself in their position. You've got 4 hours in which to paint this wonderful house. How would you begin, or how would you tell them to begin?
This happens to me so often, and a lot of information to get in very, very fast. And I find the easiest way to come to terms with it is not to draw straight away, spend a couple of minutes just looking at it, absorbing the information and about the feel of the place. And that way, your eye has already roamed over the detail and tucked away one or two bits of information which you know you'll get back to later.
So they've got the accuracy of the building, but they've also got the feeling and the atmosphere of the building.
Yeah. Well, the building has to have architectural integrity. You need to be able to walk through a door without banging your head on the ceiling when you get in there. So you need to do the measuring, see the relationships between the spaces and the places. The emotion probably comes from how you deal with the tone and the colour.
Thank you very much. Very helpful, as always.
Pleasure.
The garden could pose a little bit of a problem because it might conflict with the house itself. Because it's close to the foreground, I want to keep the foreground quite simple so that the focus really is on the house. I'll probably put some of a few of the bushes in maybe, and particularly the peacock that's been posing there now for a few hours. He's got lovely bright colours, and I think that will accentuate the depth in the picture. You know, you could walk into it and you can feel the atmosphere.
Thank you.
I've laid in two or three washes and I've let those dry. Now I'm going to trace on top of my washes the most important part of the painting, and with me it's going to be the peacocks. After I've traced it and I'm satisfied with it, then I'll go for the colour.
My training in the architectural profession in some ways is restrictive, because I tend to look at all the details, and having taken up watercolour, 5 years ago, I've had to learn to not show every nut, bolt and screw. I'm trying to do washes with colour splashes in it that will bring the feeling of the material rather than every joint or the structure of it or every detailed window.
The name Gwydir derives from the Welsh for bloody land, reflecting the many battles fought here between rival princes during the Dark Ages. The castle was built after the Wars of the Roses by a staunch supporter of the House of Lancaster named Meredith. He founded the Wynne dynasty, himself fathering over 30 children by 3 wives and 4 concubines. As the fortunes of the Wynnes ebbed and flowed, so did the grandeur of Gwydir. The first baronet, Sir John Wynne, created the double courtyard design shown in this reconstruction of Gwydir in the 17th century. Gwydir's most often cited ghost, a young woman dressed in white or grey, haunts the north wing. Her presence is often accompanied by a foul stench. She's said to be a former maid and paramour of Sir John. Allegedly, Sir John had his mistress murdered and then walled up behind the chimney, hence the smell.
I've brought the expert and the son with me.
Hi, Chris.
Hiya, Chris. It's all looking very nice, isn't it? It's beautiful, sort of soft tones and...
It's coming on.
I think it's coming on. What do you think it's coming on?
Like the texture in the sky, it's cobalt blue, always granulates in that sort of way.
One problem
like, possibly is a compositional one of having that line hard across the middle, you know, and how we bridge the gap and bring the two halves of the painting together. Right. Might be able to do it with links of colour.
Yeah, sure. I might bring the sky around into it somehow. And see what happens.
Very successful start there.
It's lovely.
Thank you.
Thanks, Chris.
Thanks, Chris.
Hi, Maz.
Hello.
Hi, Maz.
Oh, she's on to the first peacock.
Well, right. It's the first stage, Hannah.
That's pretty good.
A couple of things I'm going to pick up on. Yeah. The first is about this very formal structured art shape from somewhere else in the building. That's really nice to do.
Yes,
if you're working in quite a decorative sense, you've got a lot of leeway to play around with things like that. Second one is of a technical nature, that working those brilliant colours in, especially when we get to that viridian colour here, it'll be passing across this red, what's going to possibly be fairly dull. Two choices, either lift that colour out, if it's not stained it too much, or go to opaque colours, adding white in.
Yes.
It'll make it flat, but with a decorative piece you might get away with that flatness.
Might I get away with also with a little bit of pastel, maybe?
Yeah, it's you know, a fairly normal thing to do. It has soft edges, it'll fit quite happily with the watercolour.
Lovely.
Good.
I'm going to give it a whirl, anyway.
Give it a whirl.
See you soon, mate.
Thank you.
Hi, Ken.
Hello.
Hello. Hiya.
Hello.
Oh, that's nice.
I was talking earlier with Hannah about the enormous amount of observation you have to put into these things, the architectural detail, where things are placed in relationship to each other. You've coped with that admirably, I think, and now this colour's starting to build up. You can be a little bit more expressive with it and loosen up a bit.
Yes, that's what you want to do too, isn't it?
Well, from my training in architecture, then perspective comes easier to me than to some other artists.
Just one little point I'll pick up. That very hard edge does tend to sort of separate things into two halves. So I can see a little scrap of drawing that's coming in here, which could be the tree.
Yeah.
That's going in, is it?
Yeah.
Yeah, that'll say something about the space and the volume of the building as well. Yeah. So.
Part of it was the fact that when I put the peacock in, it tends to stand out too much, and I've been trying to
a bit of a jump
with it down.
Perhaps bring the trees, you know, almost up to it or even behind it. Thanks a lot, Ken.
Thank you.
Great.
Thank you very much.
Later.
He's got his roof line right in the midpoint. Can Chris find a way to bring the two halves of his painting together? How should Maz make sure her brilliant colours don't go flat? And is Ken going to be able to take the edge off his architectural lines?
So, these are the trials and tribulations ahead. Join us after the break.
This is the sound of magic love. A bewitching collection of timeless love songs from yesterday and today. 38 spellbinding hits with Shania Twain. Martin McCutcheon. Elton John, Lighthouse Family, Simply Red, and Ronan Keating. When you say nothing, it's Magic Love, the album, out now.
None of us are getting any younger, and for many of us that means that we're less mobile. So let me tell you about this amazing new Relax chair from Churchill's. You don't need to struggle when you want to sit down or stand up. It can also help soothe away those aches and pains which we all get from time to time. And because you can adjust it to any position, the relaxed chair is also wonderfully comfortable. Luxury! But if you're more concerned with getting a good night's sleep, take a look at Churchill's wonderful new adjustable bed. You can raise your head or your feet for maximum comfort. That could provide welcome relief for those of us who may be suffering from painful muscles or joints. What's more, you can sit up to read or watch television. All Churchill's products offer real value for money with a fast and friendly nationwide service. So why not give Churchill's a call right now?
For further information and a free brochure about the relaxed chair or Churchill's range of adjustable beds, call 0800 30 40 40 now. That's 0800 30 40 40.
Churchill's, the name to trust.
Hello, want a low-cost loan at your convenience? Whatever you want £800 to £15,000 for, call Lombard Direct on 0800 2 15,000.
Our rates reflect your circumstances and our typical APR is just 10.9%.
I've just got us a great deal on a loan.
For an unsecured personal loan of £800 to £15,000, just call Lombard Direct now on 0800 2 15,000.
Welcome back to Gwydir Castle in North Wales. The devil is in the detail of this delightful Tudor house. Will the artist manage with just 2 hours left?
During the next 2 hours, I'm going to be concentrating mainly on the focal point of the picture. I don't want it to be too central. I want it to be slightly offset. Hopefully, I'm going to be able to put the peacock in, and that's going to help to draw the eye towards that area. I agree with Mike what he was saying about cutting the picture in half. Yeah, I think it is a bit of a problem. It's one of those sort of problems you tend to have with big houses like this, especially from this vantage point. We'll just have to see. We'll have to see what happens.
Pleased with the colours, and as they've dried they still remained quite powerful. Mike suggested that maybe I wouldn't be able to cover the blushes of the watercolour I put on previous to the bird colour, the peacock colour, but it's worked so far. I'm not going to put much detail in, I'm just going to give some flashes of the pastel. Maybe make it a little bit more lush.
I'm more pleased than I thought I would be. Just still a little bit dubious about the peacock on the roof. Although I have put some trees along the roof line to try and soften my hard edge of the roof. I think I still have more work to do on that. I'm going to soak water the edge down and try and take off some of the paint or even roughen the edge up. I could scratch it out, but I'm a little bit disinclined to get the razor blade out.
Mike Chaplin, this is your big moment. It's tip of the day and you're on. What you got?
Right, we've got drawing against there. We looked at colour yesterday, back on line against there. And I just want to explore some of the linear elements that the contestants are faced with today. They've got a very elegant little herb garden growing in front of them. Mm-hmm. Nice sort of ellipse like that. And behind there is the structure of the building. Quite tight, horizontal, verticals. And it's a rather nice sort of play from one soft curve to another. So a sketch like that might well produce a portion of that taken out.
Mm-hmm. Now, ellipses are pretty difficult things to draw, aren't they?
Yes, if you're drawing freehand, I much prefer, if I can, to draw with the arm. And that's more likely to happen when you're standing up, in fact. As soon as you sit down, your hand naturally goes on the table. So let's have a look at this ellipse. Let's go back to the circle. That's not a bad one.
Very good.
See where the centre is. And let's just put the two diameters in like that, because that will be help us to understand what happens when we tip that circle back. Let's say that we understand that it's angled at 45 degrees mm-hmm. from us. This diameter will stay the same, mm-hmm. but that one will reduce by half. So the circle now travels past that point at 90 degrees, as it does there, mm-hmm. and it heads down towards this point and passes that at 90 degrees, continues on round, passes that one, and the same on the other sides. And the fact that we've made a conscious effort to make that pass at that angle gives the shape some sort of authority. Far too often, people when they're drawing bring that to a sharp point, and it loses all sense of volume if you're drawing something like a right. tube, like that.
Yes, yeah. Now, you do ellipses almost as a warm-up, don't you, sometimes?
Yes, it's just like scales would be for a singer, just to loosen up, to try and get that message from the brain down through the arm to the point of contact with the paper. And I'll spend an awful lot of time just... Let's have some anti-clockwise ones. Let's swap and do some clockwise ones.
See if we can
make the ends join up, see if we can keep that curve following fairly smoothly like that. Mm-hmm. Right, it's your turn now.
What, me?
Yes.
Do one of those?
Yes, one of those, please. Quick as you can.
I don't like this. Oh!
See? It's confidence, it's fluid movement.
Oh, I like that.
You're an absolute natural.
Goodbye. Thank you so much.
Bye, Hannah.
The contents of Gwydir were auctioned off in 1921. Then fire destroyed the tower, and the house was abandoned for decades. It was rescued by its current owners, Judy Corbett, a bookbinder, and architectural historian, Peter Welford, who have devoted their time and money to its restoration and public opening. Their greatest triumph has been the reclamation of this fabulous wood panel dining room, attributed to Inigo Jones. It was sold in the 1921 auction to the American newspaper tycoon and great collector, Randolph Hearst. He bought it for his palatial home, San Simeon, but it was never even unpacked. The panelling was discovered in New York's Metropolitan Museum, still sealed in its original crate.
I like some of the vine. I love the way the vine's climbing around the building. I've tried to highlight a few of the trunks of those vines, particularly the way that the wisteria hangs over those windows, which are just appearing out of all that green foliage. It's quite a mysterious sort of look.
The very end, I have got a little gold acrylic, and just two or three little dots will make a difference to it. I am very pleased with the peacocks. Hope somebody else will be.
Well, pen and ink was my method of drawing. I use it very little now, but it is useful just to bring out the sharpen the edge of the watercolour where it's required to emphasise a certain point of an opening or a doorway or a piece of stonework. There are areas that I won't be happy with, but this applies to any painting I do. But I'm happier today that I've achieved something from the challenge that's been set me, because it is quite hard.
I come amongst you like the spectre at the feast with the ill tidings that your time's up. So, you've already stopped painting. Well done, Chris. May I call upon the other two to do likewise? Thank you very much indeed. Thank you. Mike. Ooh, that's good.
It's amazing, isn't it, how paintings often don't reveal themselves all at once. There are little hidden things happening here, which are very subtle, and you don't see the lovely little changes of tone here.
Right, yeah.
The main one for me was how we culturally, instinctively read from left to right, whether it's to do with reading books or not, I don't know, but lines do tend to whiz out this side, and I thought, oh no, that's going to be awful. Mm. And I suddenly said, what's happened is that you very subtly change the balance of these other ones. They disappear and they disappear. Mm. The whole thing doesn't quite get to the edge.
No.
So we return back in. That's lovely.
Yeah. Well, I did do that purposefully, you know, to try to stop it from disappearing, as you say. I was originally going to bring the sky around a little bit more and make the house disappear into the sky, but I think that would have been a bit too much.
I think you've made an absolutely super job of that. Really, really nice.
It's a timeless quality. Mm. Mm. Well done, Chris.
Thank you.
How's Maz?
Oh, quite satisfied.
Good, good.
Hi, Maz.
This is so bold and so different. Do you know, to me it looks almost as if you'd gone inside. It looks like you've gone through an arch or a doorway into it.
Yeah. It's interesting to see two quite different painting styles. There's one which is almost like a silhouette puppet theatre, very very flat, very, very theatrical. And suddenly there's another bit of the painting, which is all about space and life, and that's quite intriguing to have those two different things. Mm. The other thing that's interesting, I find, that we go on and on and on about warm colours coming forward, cools one receding, and here's exactly the opposite happening. So these rules are not to be obeyed religiously, and if you can break them and get away with it, and in this case tonally, you know, it's another little intrigue.
Well, and had a good time.
Oh, I've enjoyed
the day. Has it been worth spending your birthday the day after?
Oh, yes. Oh, very much.
Little bits of pastel working well in there, didn't they?
Well, it's just enough, I think. You suggested that, just to pick it up.
I'm smashing. Yes. Well done, Maz.
Thanks, Maz.
Thank you.
There's Ken basking in sunshine.
Okay, Ken.
How do you feel you've got on today?
Relatively pleased. I won't say I'm fully pleased.
Well, we're never that, any of us, are we?
Well, and you've got the security of being able to draw so well, haven't you? Because, I mean, these are not easy by any means to do, and that strong background of drawing carries the day in the end, doesn't it? Yeah. I mean, one or two little problems with the painting, possibly. I just find that maybe a little bit too strong. You could perhaps alter that by making this even stronger. Yeah. Things are only relative, so sometimes if something's too strong, you can alter by doing something somewhere else. You never know until you've done it, really.
By getting out the line or the heavy so that, it may have emphasised it.
It may have done. It may have done. And yes, you solve one problem, create another one, don't you? That's life, isn't it? But I love the drawing in here. I think it's so accomplished and so understated, that stonework in there.
Yes, I was going to say that. It's lovely down there too, isn't
it? It's a triumph, that.
Really good piece of work.
Joy to see, Ken. Congratulations.
Thank you very much indeed.
Chris has cleverly handled the roofline. Will it bring him out on top? Can Maz's theatrical peacocks put her centre stage? Or maybe Ken's accomplished drawing will carry the day. Quite apart from winning in Watercolour Challenge, it's also about having a good time. And I think all of you have said at one point or another today that you have enjoyed today very much, and that's very important to us. But back to the winning part of it. Who has indeed won today, please?
Well, the enjoyment shows through in the paintings, doesn't it? We've got one high degree of technical proficiency in the drawing, lovely to see. One very dramatic theatrical piece, and one which is very romantic and doesn't express itself all at once. And instinct leads me towards Chris and that final expressive thing. So congratulations, Chris.
Really well done, Chris. And this for you, for another beautiful painting. And Maz, indeed for you. Well, tomorrow we travel even further north to the Isle of Anglesey. So please be there. We'll see you, I hope. Goodbye. Thank you.
Watercolour Challenge by Diana Vowles with